give a warm welcome and a huge round of applause for today's awesome LAIKA panel. So it's a one-hour event. We have started a little bit late, but we'll keep to the 1 hour. We'll begin with a short presentation, and then we'll open up a Q&A session, which will be moderated by the Emmy Award-winning character animator, Laura Barbara, who is also a Gnomon instructor here, who is super awesome. She'll be inviting some audience questions, too. So if you have a question for the panel, please raise your hand, and we'll bring a mic over to you. We do ask that you always wait for the mic, just to make sure both our guests and the live stream viewers can hear you. So yes, we are live streaming from Hollywood today. Thanks for tuning in on live stream and Facebook Live. We are limited on time today, but we will do our best to take questions. So simply use hashtag Gnomon on Twitter if you'd like to ask those. And if anyone is new to campus today, it's a good crowd, actually. We only announced the event yesterday, so thank you all for coming. If anyone is new and would like to look around the campus, we can show you around, probably around 1:30 or so if you have some time, so just let me know. Okay, so let's get started. Let's have a huge round of applause, and we'll get started. Thank you.
Hello. Everybody can hear me? My name is Steve Emerson. I am the visual effects supervisor at LAIKA and a former Gnomon student. Yeah! I gotta say, I was here, gosh, it was like 2000, maybe 2001, taking Shake classes. It is so much cooler now than it was when I was. We were upstairs in the little room, like on SGI boxes, and yeah, this thing is. It's cool now, really cool. Anyway, it's a pleasure to be here today. You guys should go ahead and introduce yourselves
sure.
as well, obviously.
My name's Brian McLean. I'm the director of rapid prototyping. I don't expect for you guys to know what the hell that title means, so I'll explain it during the presentation. I'm really proud and happy to be here, so thanks.
And I'm Brad Schiff. I'm the animation supervisor on Kubo and the Two Strings, and also very happy to be here.
Yeah. So I know you're probably used to seeing a lot of demos that are being done in real time. We were talking about possibly doing a demo for you guys today, but unfortunately, Brad, when he animates, he works at a clip of roughly 3 seconds of animation per week. So we basically meant we'd be lucky if we could get a frame in an hour, so we decided to skip that. Instead, what we're going to do is we've got some great content that we're going to show you, a little bit of behind the scenes. I'm going to show you some visual effects breakdowns from Kubo and the Two Strings. And then we thought we'd just kind of, you know, we have this, it's a fairly distinctive way of working up at LAIKA, which is using a hybrid technique, and we'll kind of get into that with the three of us and talk about what the heck hybrid is and how we make these films. So recently, LAIKA, we celebrated our 10-year anniversary at the studio. And as part of that anniversary, a video was produced just to give kind of a history of the studio, the films that we've worked on, the types of people that work there, the types of films that we've made. So we thought that'd be a great place just to start today is to share that video with you. All right.
Looking back, I guess you could say the odds have never really been tilted in our favor. Conventional wisdom says this wouldn't and shouldn't work.
Awesome!
But here we are. In our 10 years, we've learned that not only are we filmmakers, we're engineers, city planners, electricians, and adventurers. We are a passionate group of artists who believe that the smallest details help tell the bigger story. Looking forward, we continue to evolve.
Whatever your quest, it is now my quest too.
Growing our studio, our art, our craft, our technology, and our ambition.
I can't believe you did this!
A lot has happened in 10 years, but we're really just scratching the surface. As our stories continue to expand, we'll take them to bigger, bolder, and more surprising heights. For a decade, we've been doing what some might call mad, what some might call magic. We call it LAIKA.
You're just in time for supper, dear.
Can't you be like other kids your age?
Oh, baby.
I started LAIKA coming up on 10 years ago now. It was during the production of Coraline. And what I will say about the studio is it was a much different place 10 years ago. We were working on Coraline. The director was Henry Selick. And Henry at the time, you know, he was not crazy about using computers. He wanted to do, you know, basically the entire film. He wanted to be practical. He wanted to be physical. He wanted everything that you saw on screen to at one point have existed in that warehouse up in Portland, Oregon, and to have been captured through a physical camera lens. And it's not to say we didn't use computers on Coraline, because we certainly did, for facial animation. We use computers to do a ton of cosmetic work on the puppets. We have to clean them up, and animators use rigging in order to get specific performances. All that rigging needs to be painted out. And there were a few computer-generated elements in Coraline, but for the most part, Henry got what he wanted. What I will say is that when we transitioned from Coraline to Paranorman, suddenly everybody started talking about hybrid. We were going to be making hybrid films. And what I came to learn as far as what hybrid means to me is it's really about enabling storytellers. It's about storytelling without limitations. Obviously, stop-motion animation is extremely difficult to do. It takes a long time. Everything needs to be built, everything down to, you know, the salt and pepper shakers on a table. Someone has to actually physically build that. And what that means is when we make these films, a lot of times people are asked to simplify, because you can't get everything and still be responsible with the production budget. And so the idea was, well, let's embrace technology in a way that will enable us to tell whatever kind of story we want to tell with stop motion animation. Let's make bigger worlds and vast environments and have crowds of characters and big Hollywood style of effects. It's typical stuff that you would not see in a stop motion film. Let's try that. Let's expand these worlds, and let's try and, you know, realize the full potential of stop-motion animation. And what was important when we decided that we were going to start embracing technology is that we would do so in a way that was respectful of the art. So on the digital side of things, whenever we create something digitally, typically we're going to build it first. So we'll do in-camera testing to define look and characteristics of certain items that we know ultimately may end up digital in the film. When we build puppets, if we're doing digital characters, we're working with all the same people that are building the physical puppets across the street. When we're animating digital puppets, we're reporting to and working with Brad, just as the stop-motion animators across the street are. Facial animation for those puppets, we're working with Brian and his team. So it's an extremely collaborative atmosphere. And for the digital side, I think ultimately it enables us to deliver visuals that are distinctive, because quite honestly, I don't think anybody else is crazy enough to do it that way. Let's build it first, and then let's set it aside, and then let's start talking about what this thing's going to look like when it's digital. It's like we almost do it twice, you know? So thought maybe the next thing we can do is we can show some of the breakdowns from Kubo and the Two Strings. And what this will do, if you're familiar with shot breakdowns, basically it's going to show you the raw plates as they were captured out on the stages. And then you'll start to see some of the different digital components come in. Some of them will be digital. Some of them are also background plates that were captured out on the stages. If you're not sure, that's a really good thing. It means we're doing our job well. But typically, with a lot of the digital stuff, you're going to see it flash gray first. So we'll run the breakdowns, and then maybe we'll start a dialogue just talking about some of the hybrid workflow and how we collaborate up there.
Yeah, one thing I want to add is, you know, we talk about hybrid, we talk about all these different groups, but to give you guys sort of an idea of some stats behind LAIKA, on Kubo and the Two Strings, I think the crew was around 400. Out of that 400, how many were from the visual effects side?
About 65.
65,
yeah.
And then stop motion animators?
35 stop motion animators.
35. There's about 75 people in the puppet department who are building the puppets. There's about 60 people in the rapid prototyping department, which is my department. And then we have art department and stages and lighting and camera. So it's a pretty large group of people that come together with different disciplines to make these films possible.
Yeah. On the visual effects side, I'll just say that our entire team is about the size of the lighting team at Pixar. But okay, so yeah, we'll run the breakdowns, and then we'll talk all about it. Here we go. So a typical question that we get asked when we do these types of presentations is, how do we decide what's going to be physical and what's going to be computer-generated in these films? And the where we've sort of landed as a studio is, early on in the process, we have the script, we break down the script becomes storyboards and animatics, and then we all get in this room together and we go through shot by shot and we figure out how we're going to execute it. And pretty much the way we go about it is, if we can get it in camera, we absolutely are going to get it in camera. If there is what we call a hero character or a main character that is in a given shot, that character is always going to be hand animated. And will be a stop-motion puppet. The environment around that character will always be physical. Things that are it may be interacting with will be physical as well. But then once we start to move beyond that, all bets are off. And again, we try to get as much as we possibly can, but then when it comes down to, okay, if a given set is not available, if there's not enough set or resources in the art department, then we'll start talking about extending things digitally. When we do digital work on these films, I mean, again, everything is physical first, so we'll work with the puppet department. If we're doing computer-generated puppets, they will provide us with all of the materials, real materials that should be on those puppets. When we're building digital sets and extensions, they will actually build miniature maquettes that will be scanned, that will become the basis for anything that's ultimately digital. And then on top of that, again, we will be given all the materials that need to make up those given environments. So it's just a very, very collaborative process. The digital work that we do, it's never done in a vacuum. Certainly from my point of view, when I joined Leica during Coraline, I felt this sense of movie magic that I hadn't felt in a long time. Like creative problem solving to get things in camera, wondering how the heck they pulled off a given visual. I think today, with a lot of the technology that we have and with the computer work, which is dynamic and it's beautiful, but it's there's something about when I take my kids to go to the movies, and we're walking out together, we could have just seen the most extraordinary visual, completely mind-blowing, and it's always sort of dismissed as, it was done on a computer. And the visual effects industry, obviously, it was the foundation for the industry was built by gentlemen who didn't have those resources. And I think there was a real magic to their art of figuring things out and how to get them in camera. So we're really trying to hang on to that and to innovate on top of it. What else, guys?
Steve likes to talk.
Yeah.
Yeah. He also likes to clap. So,
yes, definitely.
So, I think that was a great setup, and I think that explains a lot about our process and our approach to filmmaking. And, we are reviving or using one of the oldest forms of special effects and visual effects for the basis of our films, which is stop motion. But we're not afraid to try completely new ways of solving problems or combining technologies. And that's sort of the root of my department, which is the rapid prototyping department. And I came to Leica 10 years ago before the beginning, before production on Coraline. And I came there with a guy named Martin Meunier, and we had this crazy idea of taking this age-old form of replacement animation, which was used for almost a century, where essentially you would have a sculptor that was hand-sculpting different facial expressions that you were then putting onto a puppet and taking a frame, a picture of that facial expression, and then replacing it with a slightly different expression. We had an idea of what happens if you were to take that replacement animation technique and fuse it with 21st century 3D printing technology. We would animate the faces, model the faces in the computer, and then we would send facial geometry to a 3D printer that would produce a physical 3D object. We were the first studio to try that on Coraline, and the idea with it was, how can we, really breathe life into these stop-motion puppets? How can we get them to have emotional ranges and lip sync and expressions that they really couldn't have had in the past? And that technique proved to be really successful on Coraline, and we have just continued to adopt and adapt that from every film. And Kubo and the Two Strings, we were using some really cutting-edge 3D printing technology. But the other thing we were doing for the first time is we were controlling the 3D printer on our own. Meaning normally when we had sourced the 3D printer and decided on what type of 3D printer we were going to use for one of our films, we would buy the printer and whatever 3D printing software came with it, we just were using and we were sort of shoehorning our process into that 3D printing software. But on Kubo, for various reasons, we decided that the hardware that was available to us, it was actually this beta hardware, it actually hadn't even been released to the public yet, was really exciting, it had a lot of potential, but the software that ran the printer was really antiquated and limited. So, you know, for the first time we said, all right, we have a lot of knowledge about 3D printing, we've made quite a name for ourselves in the 3D printing world over the last 10 years, not only from what we're doing with, you know, revolutionizing how 3D printers are used, but a lot of had to do with how much resin and 3D printed material we use when we're doing one of our films. On Box Trolls and Paranorman, we happen to be the number one consumer of color 3D printed material in the world. So what that does is it means 3D printing companies are really eager to work with us. So we were able to go back to these 3D printing companies and say, hey, let us develop our own software to run the printer. You give us exclusive access to the machine, and we'll find a way to run it. So it's a little bit like going to Apple and saying, we love your iPhone, but we hate your operating system. Let us develop our own operating system. And they allowed us to do it, and it was really exciting because basically what we're able to do for the first time ever is control a printer on a voxel level. I don't know if you guys are familiar with what a voxel is, three-dimensional pixel, but we were able to control color placement in plastic voxels that we'd never been able to do before. And for the audience member that doesn't, you probably can't even see the difference, but there were three characters on Kubo that we used this brand new technology for. It was Monkey, Beetle, and the Moon Beast. And those were done with a plastic 3D printer. And what was really fun about that time on Kubo was, you know, if we were to have taken one of those 3D printing faces out of the studio and snuck it into a 3D printing conference filled with 3D printing nerds from around the world, they would instantly recognize that that face I was holding in my hands was truly unique. And no other studio, no other company, no other 3D printing bureau had the technical capabilities of producing that plastic piece that I had in my hands, just because of that unique collaboration of us being able to sort of control the printer on our own software. So we have a little video here. It's called Face Bakers. It was made back on Paranorman. But it's a good way of describing how we do our process. Now, everything you see in this particular video is not the new plastic 3D printing that I was just talking about. This is a powder 3D printer that we started using on Paranorman, Box Trolls, and we used it for the human characters on Kubo. So Kubo was created with this powder 3D printing. And I can talk your guys' ear off about how the pros and cons of powder 3D printing versus plastic 3D printing. So the other thing I'll say is the reason I called Steve out for talking a lot is because I talk even more. And a little bit like Trump, I was trying to, you know, accuse him of something that I do even worse. So.
Are we face fakers?
Yeah.
Let's see if we get this.
It's crazy. It's really crazy.
It's a lot of extra work, a lot of extra
stuff. It's an insane process.
This stuff, it does not move.
Bubby wubby boo.
That's not his chin.
On Paranorman, how are we going to animate the faces?
Replacement animation.
Replacement animation.
Replacement animation, where each face is put on and it's a new mouth shape.
That's how you get the most out of your characters.
So 24 mouth shapes will make up a second of vocabulary or emotion.
Actually, we're learning about it in school.
Oh, yeah!
And what, you know, one of the big things about taking something out and putting a different object in is how it registers, how it's going to appear like the last one.
Because if you think about having a different face upwards of 12 to 24 times a second,
the color has to be exactly the same. The shape has to be exactly the same. They have to work perfectly.
Yeah, of course. Don't get weird or anything.
These faces are done with a powder printer.
It just lays down a really thin layer of powder until eventually you have a three-dimensional object.
Something like this?
Yeah, something like this.
And you take that face and you dip it into a super glue.
Awesome!
We've already designed them. We know they work. Now we need to make
thousands and thousands of different facial expressions.
So you have so much stuff to make.
Here's a recipe we used for the film Paranorman. We started out with 8,000 pounds of printing powder.
77 gallons of super glue.
300 puppets.
40,000 faces.
50 stages.
5,000 X-Acto blades.
66,400 rare earth magnets.
729 sheets of sandpaper.
2 gallons of white resin.
25,000 purple nitrile gloves for safety reasons.
You need a massive warehouse?
Yeah, you need a lot of room.
Put those all together and bake for 127 human years. Got yourself a stop motion feature.
Yum.
Yeah.
I'm gonna just finish. I'm gonna say a couple more things.
Well, I was just gonna do a quick show of hands. How many people here think Brian should shave the beard? Go back to yes.
Oh, none.
Yes.
Yes.
No, yeah. No.
That's why we haven't updated that video, because that was 8 years ago.
Yeah. Yeah, you look so young. You look so young, yeah.
Before the bags under my eyes, which is why I wear glasses now to cover them up. So on Kubo, we ended up printing about 66,000 facial expressions. You guys could probably see in that video that we bisect the face into two different sections. We have an eyebrow and a mouth, and there is it allows the animator to independently remove either the mouth or the eyebrow and get a different expression. But there is a seam line that Steve's team needs to go in there and digitally erase. And you guys have to do it twice because we're shooting it in stereo, so you got to erase the left eye and the right eye.
We've worked all that out, though.
Yeah. And the other thing I wanted to mention is, after Box Trolls, we were actually recognized by the Academy, and we received a scientific and engineering Oscar for pioneering this use of 3D printing in stop motion animation. So we're really excited by that, and we just continue to sort of push the boundaries of what's possible. And you know, looking back on the beginning of Kubo, the reason why we were really forced into trying something new and abandoning what we had been using very successfully with trying this whole new plastic 3D printer, all was there to sort of service the design, aesthetic, and the story. Those really tender moments of Monkey in the cave with Kubo telling her story would not have been possible with the previous color printing that we had been using, just because of the imperfections. A lot of that subtlety in the animation, and a lot of that subtlety in the beautiful performances that Brad and his team were able to put in these puppets would have been lost by the chatter or the inconsistency. For a long time, I tried to call that chatter RP charm, but that didn't fly. So now it's just referred to as chatter.
Yeah. So, and the 3D printing was really a game changer for facial expressions and stop motion animation. Excuse me. I got to work on Tim Burton's Corpse Bride and Fantastic Mr. Fox, and on Corpse Bride, you had the silicone face that was over an armatured skull, so you could, manipulate the brows. If you stuck a hex wrench in the ear and you turned it towards the back of the head, it would pull the corner of the mouth up to a smile. If you turned it towards the front of the head, it would take it down to a frown. And it was really cool, but like if you moved it literally a millimeter the wrong way, the character was totally off model. And with a team of 30 plus animators, the facial expressions were all over the place. So with 3D printing, we wound up with a consistency. So regardless of what animator's animating it, your character stays on model, which has been fantastic. And the other thing is you do the faces weeks, sometimes months ahead of time. So they have to, they have to print the faces, process the faces. And then when the stop motion animator's out there getting ready to do their shot, they deliver a face kit, like this whole, boxes of faces with each, each face on your X sheet. So on frame two that you're using, this face. On frame three, you're using this other one. And they're all in order. So at that point, it becomes plug and play for the stop motion animator, and the animator can concentrate that much more on the body performance and the cloth performance and the hair performance because, as you know, there's no hair simulation or cloth simulation in stop motion.
Okay. Yeah. Animation perspective, Kubo and the Two Strings, some of the most difficult stuff that you guys were doing, obviously it was hair mm-hmm. and it was fabrics.
Yeah.
You want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, you know, again, because there's no hair simulation, you have to be able to, you know, you have to manipulate this painstakingly one frame at a time. And, you know, you've never seen a stop motion film with long hair and baggy clothes because it's a total pain in the ass. And it's really hard to do. And, you know, I lost many nights sleep over how we were gonna deal with Kubo's kimono. And, you know, because you have to touch it every frame. It needs to move, but you don't want it to chatter. And so working with the costume department and the art director, we came up with an origami approach to the costumes. And we used Tyvek material, which is similar to what you have in your overnight mailers, you know, that stuff, that really strong material. And so with the Tyvek, it stayed in the shape that you wanted it. So you could touch it and it would always kind of go back to its default position. But with foils and wires, you were able to manipulate the sleeves and the cuffs and the bottom of the kimono, and it just made it control the want to work in a treat. It was a pain in the behind for the animators, but it worked really well. And then the hair, it's all wired. So, you know, if all of you seen Kubo and the Two Strings, you know, like every little bit of little settle and blowing in his hair, that was all done by hand by a stop motion animator. So all his hair is, it's I think it was real human hair, wasn't it?
Yeah, combed with silicone.
Combed with silicone with wire, aluminum wire inside it.
That's why we all have short hair, because we were forced to shave it at the beginning of the production.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Kubo's bangs, we actually had to engineer and design a way to remove his bangs so the animators could gain access to remove his faces. And
yeah, that's right, because his hair hangs over his face. So it was like, oh my gosh, how are we going to do that? So, yeah, they wound up doing a piece. So every time you wanted to change a face, you had to take his bangs off, and then you put the face, you know, take the bottom of his mouth off, and then his brows off, and you put it back on. You put the bangs back on. And we had to actually do some back and forth because, you know, again, the first couple versions we did, when you would pinch the side of his bangs to take his hair off, it would move, and the animator would be sitting there for another, you know, 15 minutes or half hour trying to get it back to where it was. So we had to do a lot of back and forth to get it so it wouldn't move every time you took those things off.
Yeah, the really fun thing about our films, working on them, is that, you know, Leica really doesn't have a distinct style. Every movie has different character designs, different environments. And with that change in design requires that we go through an exploration process, not only at the beginning of the film, really all the way through the film, as designers and builders to try to figure out how we're going to achieve the new looks or the new puppets. And they all have unique challenges, and there's probably two dozen inventions that if we wanted to, we could go in there and patent that were necessary solutions for us to build a puppet. Audience members never see them. They're most likely in a little new armature and design or something inside the eye rig, how an animator would move the eyeballs around. But it's a necessary process to sort of be able to deliver the puppets in a performance, or puppets that can perform the way that we're expecting them to perform.
All right. So we have some behind-the-scenes time-lapse footage of Leica animators mm-hmm. we're going to share with you next. You guys good?
Yeah.
Run it?
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you. guitar gently weep. I look at you all, see the love there that's sleeping, while my guitar gently weeps. Look at you all, still my guitar gently weeps.
Think about the universe, Mr. Trout. What if our world is just like a tiny speck?
A tiny little speck.
And there are giants looking down on us.
And every time we move...
It's actually them moving us.
Seems a bit tedious.
Like that. Just there. Me blinking. That would have taken them a day.
Me moving my arm. 500 men.
I mean, none of them are going home. They're having to do this bit. And now this bit. On this bit. I mean, this should stop.
All right, so we talked a little bit about visual effects, rapid prototyping, animation. Do you want to open it up, do some Q&A?
Yeah, does anybody All right. have any questions right now?
Yep, I'm going to run to you. Running.
One, thank you so much for coming here. This is like the coolest thing ever. Oh my god. Two, what do you guys look for portfolios for interns?
That's a great question. I think we have, I'll speak specifically for the rapid prototyping department. We are primarily based in a CG environment, meaning that we are modeling, rigging, texture painting. We're using computers to produce our physical objects. So we look for, you know, people with animation skills, painting skills, I personally look for traditional sort of art background, gesture drawings, figurative drawings. Those are things that I personally look after or look for. I don't know what you guys...
Yeah, and you know, when we look at stop motion interns, we're just looking at somebody's stop motion animation. We want to see somebody's understanding of motion, how smooth somebody's stuff is, how natural their animation can be. You know, because we shoot a very naturalistic style of animation at Leica. You know, it's not cartoony, and even though in a cartoony reel, you can see somebody who could have the talent to do what we're trying to do.
But, yeah. Yay? Huh? I ask the guy. I go to my leads and say, "Hey, what do you think?" And then they say yes or no. Okay. But yeah, I will say that the studio is growing. I mean, we just added on. It's like almost another 100,000 square feet. There's a push to try and get to a production schedule where we can do a film a year. We have the footprint now where we can actually put the stages up to start to support that. It's going to be all about, at this point now, just resources. So
it is,
should definitely touch base with the recruiters.
And it is amazing to look at the eclectic background people have at the studio. We have philosophy majors, we have computer majors, we have people who are jewelry designers. And they all sort of have this love of creating things with their hands and love and a basic artistic talent that has just driven them into whatever sort of creative fields that they're in. So that's sort of the least common denominator is a love for the art.
Thanks so much.
Yay, welcome.
We have another question here.
Yeah, how do you guys decide the scale of like the set pieces and also like the design that goes into that?
Well, the puppet, you know, it all kind of starts with the puppets. And we've decided on the sweet spot of about 7 inches or so. Norman's about that size. Eggs was a little bit taller. Kubo is about that size. And it's a size that seems to work really well for stop motion animation, that you can get all the articulation that you want out of a character and all the subtlety you want. But it's also small enough that you don't have to make the sets enormous, you know, because you're limited in space. We have a huge warehouse, but at the same time, you don't want to have your sets, you know, that large. So it's really the puppets that set the scale for everything else.
And it's really interesting. The largest puppet we ever did, which was the giant skeleton that you guys saw in the behind the scenes, Oliver Jones, who isn't here, he's another one of our nominees. He was the animation rigging supervisor, and he conceived of how that giant skeleton was going to move. And the main reason why we did that scale versus just doing it as a smaller version that you guys we'd comp up and then have the characters running all over, mainly was because we knew it was going to be hard as hell and it had never been done before. That was a big challenge. And then the other reason was just it was going to look better in the end. There was that critical contact of monkey being held in the hands and beetle climbing all over the head. So we sort of went all in and tried to figure out how it was going to work.
It's great. Yeah, for whatever reason, we always pursue the hardest path.
Yeah, it's always the hardest way.
We really like to challenge it. But it is roughly, we're working roughly at 1/6 scale. And just in the case of the hollow bone skeleton, what was funny about, we did do a smaller scale of the skeleton that was going to be used. And then we were talking about just creating components at full scale or large scale for the different shots that would need it for interaction with the puppets. And they started to map out the portions of the skeleton that would need to be built.
That's right.
And it ended up basically, it was the whole thing.
Yep. Yeah.
So at that point, we said, all right, let's just build it.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, it's roughly 1/6 scale.
Yeah. And even our 1/6 scale one rivaled, you know, the size of our largest puppet to that point, which was the Mecha Drill. So, you know, even the small one was, you know, it was massive.
Yeah.
Can you guys talk a little bit about what your backgrounds are? So we have a former Gnomon human. Where did everybody else kind of start from?
I went to school for traditional model making, traditional sculpting back in Boston. So I got out of school knowing how to draw, paint, and sculpt a human form, but did not know how to write an email. I was extremely adverse to computers. In fact, this is in the mid-90s, and I was very intimidated by them. And I went, moved to San Francisco, worked doing model making and traditional sculpting. And it was there that I started to meet people from ILM, ultimately met that guy I mentioned earlier, Martin Meunier. And it was that exposure to model making and that industry, but then also ultimately 3D printers. When I was first introduced to a 3D printer, that was the bridge between the digital and the physical world. That was the thing that was gonna, it was exciting to me because it meant that I could still have that tactile feeling of holding something in my hand, but then I could have the power of the computer. So I've told the story many times. Martin and I pitched the idea of using 3D printers for Leica. They hired us. We went up and started setting up the department, and I didn't know how to use Maya. So I was there doing Maya tutorials, and anytime someone would walk in the room, I'd quickly shrink the screen and pretend. Story of my life. I'm just one chapter ahead.
You got to fake it till you make it.
Yeah. And I, out of high school, I went to college to be an art major, and it turns out I couldn't draw very well. So that didn't.
You can't. I've seen it.
That didn't go very well. But I had a friend who was going to school down in the University of Tampa who was taking these animation classes, and he couldn't draw very well either. But he had this instructor who used to do these beautiful watercolor animations, and he had this philosophy that you don't have to draw great to animate great. And I thought, well, that sounds intriguing. So I wound up transferring schools down there so I could take this guy's classes, and I discovered I had the ability to sculpt. So I started doing stop motion animations, and it was really it's so bizarre, you know, just like all of a sudden I started, you know, I couldn't animate really that well because I, you know, it was pre-frame grabbers. It was, you know, so I didn't really know what I was doing. But the fact that I could sculpt, the films looked decent, you know, and I made a couple films in school. I wound up getting into NYU film school for graduate school, majoring in stop motion, and got out in 1995, and there really wasn't all that much. I think it was a nightmare at that point. So retrospectively, it was a really stupid thing to go to school for back in 1995. But it's all turned out, you know. It's and I caught on this, you know, incredible wave of stop motion animation, and it, you know, there were a couple lulls, and it always seemed like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna have to learn the computer. And every time I'd sort of, you know, resigned to the fact that I was gonna have to learn Maya, then another stop motion job would come up, you know. And it happened over and over again, and now it's just been this incredible wave of stop motion.
It's awesome. You worked on Celebrity Deathmatch in New York.
I did. That was my first everyday gig with Celebrity Deathmatch.
Right. So that was one of the first things I think that exposed a newer generation to stop motion that hadn't seen it before.
That's right. You know, it was so, I got out of school in 95, and at that point, James and the Giant Peach was wrapping up production, and there was a show called Bump in the Night that was going on in San Francisco. So at that time, San Francisco was sort of the hub of stop motion in the United States. So I moved to San Francisco, and there wasn't any, you know, James ended, ABC bought, or Disney bought ABC at that time, and they got rid of any shows that were not Disney shows. So Bump in the Night went away, and, you know, so any commercial work went to those guys that had worked on that show. A lot of those guys wound up going and doing computers, working at Pixar, and going down to Disney. And so, yeah, it was a lot of temping at Bank of America for 3 years until 98 when Celebrity Deathmatch started doing their series. And I went back to New York to work on that for 6 months and then wound up in Portland at Will Vinton Studios working on the PJs. And, yeah.
It's awesome. Good question.
So you guys were talking a bit about rapid prototyping in terms of puppets and characters, but I wanted to know a bit more about the back and forth that goes into rapid prototyping and 3D printing as far as engineering for costumes and sets.
Yeah, we have done not necessarily sets, I would say more prop pieces. We started really playing around with using the 3D printer for model making back on Coraline. We had certainly sort of gotten ahead of ourselves and gotten in over water with the facial animation and trying to produce faces on Coraline. I remember we convinced the producer that all we needed was three people, one printer, and $30,000, and we could do the entire film Coraline, and we were wrong on so many levels. But at that point, people started to realize that it was a really powerful tool. But we try to use it sparingly. We certainly don't want to just use it because it's a cool tool. We want to use it when it makes sense. And over the years, I think we've done that very effectively. And it sort of culminating to on Kubo and the Two Strings, we used it to produce Moonbeast, which was the first time we had ever fully 3D printed a puppet. Normally, we just obviously 3D print the faces. And then there's a lot of designing and engineering of the what we call the head core, which is basically a puppet skull. But on Kubo, because of the plastic printer, we had the capabilities of actually getting in there and producing a full puppet, which was pretty amazing, and it was a lot of problem solving and a lot of sort of tricks to get that to work. But you know, there's been talk about, you know, you can get all sorts of different types of 3D printers, from printers that produce huge, they have huge beds that you could do literally set pieces, but it's not necessarily cost effective. Our rule of thumb for 3D printing is, you know, if you're going to need to produce multiples of something, it makes sense to dedicate the time and the resources to model the thing, paint it, go through all the color matching to then produce 10 or 15 of them. But if it's anything less than that, it's just a lot easier and a lot more economical to have a sculptor or a model maker just model it and paint it. I mean, when I say model maker, a practical model maker.
Are there digital puppets of all the characters in addition to the stop motion puppets?
There's not digital
dupes.
No. I mean, we do digital extras for background characters. Is that what you're getting at?
Sure.
Yeah. So that process is we started doing it on Paranorman, and basically the rule right out of the gate was certainly all hero characters, main characters. We're going to be physical hand-animated puppets. And then we started out with two rows of stop-motion puppets. And then once you get beyond those first two rows, we could develop digital extras. And they looked really good. And we developed them very much in collaboration with the puppet department. They guide our efforts. They inform our efforts. They give us all of the materials. We run through the same layers of approval that the physical puppets do. And in the end, when we bring them to life and we start to animate them, we're working with the same animation supervisor that the stop-motion animators are. But what ended up happening was they looked really good, and then we're always strapped for puppets, and then suddenly it was one layer, and we can go digital. And then now, you know, we'll take a digital character and drop them into frame at any given place when necessary. And again, it goes back to it's what's it going to take to enable the director to tell the story that he or she wants to tell. And if they need, you know, a couple of extras in the background, puppet departments unable to deliver those, or we don't have the animation time on the stages, then we'll build those digital extras.
And you know, it's important to make sure that they move like our stop motion puppets, so they're rigged, you know, to move in the same places that our stop motion puppets are. And you know, with the cloth, particularly the kimonos, you know, we went back and forth, and you know, there were some tests that were really beautiful, and you had this flowy fabric, but it moved in a way that we couldn't physically do it on set, so we wound up having to simplify the points of articulation.
We have the same limitations in our digital rigs that they do on the physical puppets. Mm-hmm. So
but to that, I think you're so Kubo. All the main characters, anytime you saw them in the film, they were practical puppets.
Yeah.
That's great. I'm gonna run back here. So thank you guys for coming, first of all, and for along with all the other 400 people that worked on the film for making a beautiful film. I really enjoyed it. My question was, how many puppets do you have for like a specific character? And do you guys? I'm assuming that you guys have to like take into account like shot specific variations of them. I wanted to know if you could expand on that. How much does that actually play into like figuring out the puppets that you need?
Like Kubo, we had 28 Kubos, all with different, you know, a lot of them had, you know, because he had so many different costume changes, or his costume got tattered along the, you know, and destroyed along the way. And then we had the armored Kubo, we'd have Kubo with the shamisen on his back, no shamisen, torn kimono. So, you know, because he's the main character, you're going to have, you know, with a team of 30 animators, he's in a lot of scenes. So you're going to, you know, you can have, you know, with 28 puppets, you could have 28 animators animating him at any particular time. Monkey, also, we had 22 monkey puppets. And, you know, we had wet monkeys who, you know, on the fight for the boat. We had a monkey whose hair was a little more articulated for the scene in the snow. And so, you know, because there's so much to shoot, you know, you'll have multiple animators shooting the same character on different sets and different scenes at the same time.
There's a lot of planning that goes into it. We break down the script with the puppet department, figure out, you know, because it takes a long time, upwards of sometimes 6 to 8 months to build a hero puppet. They can be worth, you know, almost $100,000 a piece sometimes. So with all that time, you definitely need to go in there and plan out when you're going to get the first puppet and then the duplicate puppets. But one thing Brad said that still blows my mind, I'm not an animator, so this impresses the hell out of me, that there's a team of 30 animators, and they can be animating. Each of them could have their Kubo on different sets, and they not only are having to bring this little puppet to life, but they're having to give it a personality that is going to sync up with the person next to them, because oftentimes their shot is being intercut with somebody else who's doing a Kubo performance 6 months later or 6 months earlier. So I don't know how you guys do it, how you, you know, bring these things to life, but also give them a consistent personality.
You know, part of it, you know, we develop a character, you know, an extensive character Bible at the beginning of a project. So as we start to get the character, you know, in the puppet, we test the armature, we test the cloth, we start to get live action reference and how we want this character to move, how we want him to act, nuances we want him to have. And so all the animators can access this Bible. so they can, you know, go online and they can see how the character moves. We review that stuff all the time. And so another thing, you know, and part of it also is scheduling. So Brian was saying, you know, any given time you could have two animators animating right next to each other. We try to not do that. It's kind of the way we did it on Coraline. But in order to try to make things feel more consistent and also to have allow the animator to have more ownership, is we've tried to give animators chunks of the film, you know, scenes, as opposed to just individual shots where they're peppered in between other people's stuff, because it allows things to remain consistent. And even if there's a slight variance of style, it kind of goes away, you know, because they're not back to back to back.
We have a live stream question. There was a scene in the behind-the-scenes footage where they had a mechanism to simulate waves. How much of the ocean was CG and how much was practical?
So the water systems were entirely CG in Kubo and the Two Strings. But that said, it is, again, when we're doing digital work, we always want to make sure that they are informed by and grounded in practical approaches and effects. So how it all works is in the case of water, you know, we've done water in past films. We had, there was the shower in Coraline, which was done using 3D replacement animation. In Paranorman, there's a scene in the bathroom stall where his uncle visits him, and we did some 3D replacement animation on water coming out of the toilet, and then we were using petroleum-based jellies and things for the puddles on the floor, because you can actually shape them and move them one frame at a time. For Kubo and the Two Strings, it was crazy because we were talking about we needed oceans, and we needed big waves, and we needed puppets were going to be performing on a boat as it's disintegrating in the middle of a stormy sea. They're being rained on, water's accumulating in the boat, they're diving off of the boat, getting into the water, going under the water, coming out of the water, jumping back into the boat. It was crazy. And again, it's like water is something you want to avoid. And so we're going to open the movie with giant waves. We're going to do this crazy action sequence in the middle of the film. So what ended up happening was we were fortunate in that right about the time we were getting started, Rhythm and Hues was closing its doors, and they had just finished Life of Pi. We got the effects water lead from Life of Pi. His name was David Horsley, to come up to Portland. And David was able to put together a workflow for us where we could get to photoreal water really quickly. And then it was about, okay, now we can do photoreal, but how do we make it look like water that belongs in this world? And Oliver Jones, who is another nominee, and the guy is just, he's a witch with these, like, these practical solutions to simulate nature. And he does, you know, things. He put together wave systems with shower curtains. You know, he uses a lot of ripple glass and lighting effects. But the one that everybody really responded to was he built a grid system where he had laid garbage bags over the top. And he would undulate the system, and you would see the weight of the garbage bags would fall into the gaps of the grid, and we started getting this really, really cool scoop patterning throughout. And it felt very much on style for the design and the look for Kubo. So then what we do is we take that practical approach, we do a photoreal recreation of that, so that becomes our foundation, and then we end up blending it with an ocean simulation. And then we start iterating. We're putting more of the look of the show into it, more design elements. We needed spray, we needed churn, we needed white caps. All of it needed to be designed. All of it needed physical reference. The art department, a lot of the churn and white caps were done with cut paper. They gave us very specific reference for that in terms of composition. We would take those elements, we'd fold them into the water system. We spent the better part of 8 months developing the water system for Kubo. Again, it was hugely collaborative, and ultimately, it's one of my favorite things about the film. It's distinctive, it feels like it belongs there, and I love it that people don't know if it's CG or real, and they ask that question.
Yeah. I have another question.
All right.
Yeah, the 66,000 faces of the puppet, it was made with a 3D printer?
Yep, 66,000 were made with a 3D printer.
But the 3D printers are very slow. It must have taken hours and hours.
It's they're very slow. You know, I was recently introduced at a 3D printing conference for working at LAIKA, the studio that is pioneering mass production with 3D printers. And I never thought about it like that before. And we really are using these rapid prototyping machines to produce objects that we are expecting to be extremely consistent in both color and geometry. And there's a lot of tracking that we do to make sure that, you know, these things are consistent. And we're producing them at a volume that no other place is really doing. So yes, to your question, the 3D printers can be extremely slow.
How long did it take to print?
Well, a Kubo face, the powder printers are a lot faster. The powder printers, you could do one Kubo face in about an hour, but then you could do a whole bunch of them, almost a whole tray, and it was maybe you could do 70 in 12 hours. Because think about your 3D printer like your inkjet printer at your house. By the time it goes to spray down, warm up and spray down the ink for the letter A, it takes about the exact same amount of time as if you were to do a whole sentence. That printer head still has to do that same pass. 3D printer is the same way. So you definitely get more economy when you throw more parts at it. But the Moon Beast that we printed, Moon Beast was such a large character. We could only print about 12 of those, and it would take 40 hours to produce 12 Moon Beast faces. And that would only produce about a half a second of footage. So we were having to spend 80 hours of printing just to get 1 second of facial animation for Moon Beast.
Yeah, I'm always joking with Brian that there's not really a whole lot that's rapid about rapid prototyping.
Yeah. How many hours did you do for 66,000 faces?
We haven't done the math. I think for Moonbeast, it was something like Moonbeast alone was 176 days of 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, straight printing. And he was only in that film for maybe 2 minutes, a minute and a half, something like that.
We have another question here.
First off, thank you for amazing presentation and everything. I had a question about lighting. Like, how do you manage between, like, the practical and the digital? Like, how do you approach when you have, like, two things going on?
Well, everything that we do up there, it's very much a live-action visual effects workflow. And what's amazing is, you know, we have our visual effects facility, and we're right across the street from the warehouse where everything is being shot. And so we're able to actually go over and grab lighting cameramen and bring them over and have them desk side with our lighters. We go get the director of photography and he'll come over and he'll stand desk side and give notes on lighting. It's very, very collaborative in that sense. But it's typical live action visual effects. We do have a lot of time to do. We do set scans. We do a lot of survey. We shoot HDRs for everything. So we have a ton of data by the time we actually sit down and start to light the digital components of a given set.
And on Moonbeast, one of the things that's really unique about him is that we knew because of the way we were going to 3D print him, we couldn't get the exact design and the glow and the shimmer that we needed to for his final look. But because we're shooting these stop motion, we're essentially freezing time. So an animator would pose Moonbeast, and instead of just taking one frame, we worked out with the visual effects department and lighting and camera many different lighting scenarios that would ultimately be able to be combined and composited to generate Moonbeast's final look. So I think it was an animator, pose the puppet, hit a button, it would take a white light pass, a UV pass, a modeling pass, and all that stuff would get dumped over to VFX.
Sometimes it takes, you're sitting there for two, you hit the button and the animator's sitting there for a minute or 2 minutes before they can get up and touch the puppet again. So it's kind of hard for the animator at times to stay in the flow of what they're doing. But it really, it helps everybody else out along the way.
He's just trying to justify only getting 3 seconds of film. Blame everyone else.
Yeah. But we did use, we used invisible UV paint that we would paint on the puppets. And then, the lighting setups, it's all automated. So the lights will switch off and black lights kick on. And it's a team of about 65 people that do all the visual effects. We, on a given Leica film, we're going to do anywhere from 1,300 to 1,400 shots. It's a ton of work, so it's all about efficiency. And so fortunately, with the setups and the fact that we can control time out there, we are able to, we'll shoot something in hero lighting, and then we'll have a green screen that'll drop in. We'll get a perfect green screen on it, and so that way you can go to comp, and those guys, you know, they can extract the green screen and just get to work making everything beautiful after a few minutes, as opposed to losing half a day messing with an extraction. So it really is, it's about a lot of efficiency with our visual effects.
Is it like, do you plan everything ahead in the previous, or do you, like, when the live action shots are like, or like animation being shot, that's when you're like combining?
Well, everything's storyboarded ahead of time, and then we are doing more previs these days as well.
Yeah, but typically for just the complicated choreography and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So the way a shot will work is animator will get launched on it, they'll go out with their puppet, and the lighting and camera team have already sort of roughly set up the camera and the lighting, but then the animator will go through a block. They'll block out what the movement's going to be. That block is then reviewed with the director or an animation supervisor, and there's notes given on everything, lighting, acting, and then they go in and do a rehearsal. And then after the rehearsal, we're looking at it and evaluating again and talking about, you know, ways of efficiency, what we could do here, green the rigs, drop this, change the lighting, and then they go in and do a shot. So they are, you know, basically doing it three times before they get to the hero animation.
If they're lucky, three. In the very beginning, it's three times. You know, and the block is usually done on sixes or something like that, sixes, eights, because it's keyframing. And the rehearsal is usually done on twos, so 12 frames a second. And then the shot is 24, you know, shot on ones, 24 frames a second. But, you know, given the time constraints and having to get, you know, the reality of production, weeks into the production, the animator loses one of those. So it's either a block shoot or rehearse shoot. And again, it's only like the complicated choreography where we'll stick to the three passes or three attempts.
How often do you have to redo shots? So
very rarely. Very rarely. I think on Kubo, we only had two reshoots during production. And then at the end, I think we went back and we reshot maybe 9 shots.
That's amazing.
Yes.
Did you have a question? Which technology are you most excited about or exploring in the next 3 to 5 years as digital or stop motion animation or physical, anything of that sort?
What are we most excited about?
I'm a 3D printing nerd, so I'm really excited by 3D printing. Can't talk much about it, but you know the future of what we're going to be doing at LAIKA is going to be harnessing some of this brand new technology that's come out, which is allowing you to do 6 colors. I didn't touch much on it before, but the technology that we're using on Kubo was only being able to mix 3 colors, so it was sort of a very limited color printer, and we used it in very creative ways to get monkey and beetles looks. But the future of that sort of plastic technology is to be able to expand those color mixings to 5 colors, cyan, yellow, magenta, black, white, but then also introducing clear, which allows you, by introducing clear, you can for the first time really control opacity and translucency. And you can not only work on just the outside, the shell of a colored object, but you can get in there and control color all the way through the object.
On the visual effects side, in a given week, we will put together, usually it's like 20 shots is kind of where our capacity is. We have 3 lighters, so they're very, very busy. A lot of times they'll kick renders onto the farm. Next day we'll come in, we'll look at them. There's never enough time to be able to re-render elements, and then you start talking about how are we going to fix this in comp. New technology we're using there now, Kubo was all done using RenderMan Rays. Now we're using RIS. And one of the really exciting things about RIS is that there is a level of interactivity with the lighters where we can actually stand over their shoulder, desk side, and look at images that it's not real time, but at least you can kind of realize the lighting desk side as opposed to just kicking it to the farm and then crossing your fingers. So RIS is really exciting for us. Yes, we do. Yeah, we do all of our effects work with Houdini.
I have another question here.
Yes. Thank you for creating all those beautiful models. And I'm always curious that after all these animations are done, so what will you do with those models? Obviously, it takes lots of time, effort to build them, and takes lots of space to storage them.
Have you guys ever seen Indiana Jones, that final scene with the huge warehouse?
Yeah,
we have one of those. Yeah, it's stacked.
We call it Siberia.
So you just saved them.
Some we do throw away. Some we do we save a lot.
Uh-huh.
We do give some to museums, and then some we actually are able to donate for charity. So we have a handful of different things we do with it.
Because before, when Disney come over, so they say actually they just use the same body and they might just replace the head for the next animation. So I wonder if you guys do the same thing.
We would love to do that, but so far every director wants their film to be completely unique.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's a good idea. Save us a lot of time.
Yes.
It's amazing that you guys have done this. Congratulations on your Oscar nomination.
Thank you.
You guys know how big a deal that is, that this got nominated for an Oscar. It's huge. It's a huge, huge deal.
It's been 24 years since a stop motion film has been nominated for a visual effects Oscar.
It's Nightmare.
Nightmare. And the really cool thing about that, you guys get sick of this story because I've said it so many times, but Nightmare Before Christmas was up against a visual effects Oscar against Jurassic Park. And that was really, when you look back at it 25 years ago, that was really the dawn of CG. And there was a very famous quote by Phil Tippett, who had made his career doing stop motion animation on the Star Wars films. He invented Go Motion. And he had been launched to do a stop-motion dinosaur test, along with, I think it was Industrial Light and Magic that were launched doing this newfangled computer-generated dinosaur test. And when he saw this computer-generated dinosaur test, the first words out of his mouth was, "I've just gone extinct." And he did it. He adapted. He evolved. He found ways to teach himself computers and sort of base computer animation on the how stop-motion animation worked. But the really neat thing about that is it's come full circle. 24 years ago, dawn of CG with Jurassic Park, and now here we are being able to represent stop-motion again in the visual effects realm is quite a huge honor. So.
It's amazing. And these guys are up for a Visual Effects Society Award tonight, too, so... break many legs, break all the legs.
Good luck.
And I think we're going to wrap things up, so I'm going to pass you back. Here we go.
The one thing I just want to say before we go is we are very honored to be able to represent the amazing crew of over 400 or 450 that make these films possible.
Absolutely.
So we have a lot of people back in Portland to thank, and they're extremely talented and hardworking individuals, and we wish they all could be up on here on stage with us tonight.
Yes.
So.
Yeah.
We wish so too. We've been trying to get Laika here for the longest time, so this is like dream come true for all of us at Gnomon. We hope you have a great award show tonight. And I've also heard, while I've been sitting over there, we have three other VES Award nominees here tonight from ILM for Rogue One. And one of them is a Gnomon alumni, Matt. So can we have a round of applause for those guys too?
Yeah.